Every year, over 100 million people go through passport control to get into Britain. Most are welcome and legal. Many are not. Tonight, for the first time on television, we go behind the scenes of the UK Border Agency, the men and women on the front line of immigration. Coming up, the chef who doesn't cut it at Terminal 3.
Everything suggests to me that you're coming to the United Kingdom to seek and take employment here.
Cat and mouse at the port of Calais.
Nationality? Iran? Iran.
And in London, an illegal worker from Nigeria is told he'll have to go home.
If I've been deported to Nigeria, they will kill me.
Valid reason to enter the country. Stamping passports today is Officer Steve Hassler. He joined immigration after a career in the RAF.
And how long have you been away?
It's his job to spot people trying to enter or stay in the UK illegally. With 50,000 passengers a day arriving at Terminal 3, he can only ask each person a handful of questions to find out if they are genuine.
What are you doing in the UK?
I'm a student.
Where do you study?
Okay,
have you got your student ID card I could have a look at?
This man is returning to Britain after visiting a sick relative in Dubai. To prove he's a student, he produces some university certificates.
Mm-hmm. So how long have you been in the UK now?
3 years.
3 years? Okay, tell me about interactive business skills. What's that?
The business skills is called it's a course, literature about the business.
No, I want to know, you got an A in interactive business skills, one of your exams, so tell me what is interactive business skills?
What's interactive business skills? Interactive business skills is a skill, it's a subject, isn't it? It is a subject.
Well, you got an A in it, so it must have been a subject.
Subject, yeah, it was everything with explanation. All about the business, it's basically the business subject, isn't it?
Just last October, you got an A in it?
Yeah.
And you can't tell me what it is?
Officer Hassler asked the passenger to wait.
Watch your bag.
While he refers to Chief Immigration Officer Rick Lindsley.
I said, well, talk to me about business interactive skills. Couldn't say a word, otherwise, oh, it's business. Asked them about introduction of IT or costing accounting. He says, couldn't do anything, couldn't even mention it. He doesn't even look like a student. I pushed on the fact about his work as well, and he's like standing there, and I said, look, are you work? Are you definitely not working? He was like, no, definitely not. I mean, he was thinking
not
about...
Not working at all?
No, nothing at all. So, I mean,
what
that's...
what do you want to do?
Certainly want to do his bag. I've got a name of a cousin who is downstairs, so I'll give him a quick call and just see if he corroborates anything he's told me as well. But he came up, and he was sort of being sort of very chatty, and then sometimes you... People do that to try and sort of catch you off guard and stuff, you know, possibly. You get colleges, as they call themselves, or educational institutions that will provide these letters, types of letters, so people can get these resident permits. And this is what this guy's on. He came here originally on a student visa. He's then submitted documentation, probably letters like this to show that he's doing, you know, good study. But clearly he hasn't done the exam because he can't talk about it. Not that I'm prejudging, of course.
Officer Hassler may have his suspicions, but he needs some facts to back them up.
Hi, this is immigration at Heathrow Terminal 3.
Yeah, he starts by calling the man's cousin.
And what does he do in the UK? Student.
The passenger has told Officer Hassler that he studies in London and doesn't have a job, not even part-time.
So he works as a taxi driver? Just spoke to the cousin and he says he works as a taxi driver, which is clearly different from what he's telling us on
who
the
works as a passenger works.
Yeah.
It's certainly a breakthrough. But before Officer Hassler can deny the passenger entry, he needs solid evidence or a full admission.
And before I start, you need to be aware it's very important for you to answer my questions truthfully. If at any time I find out subsequently that you've lied to me, then it's going to make your situation far more serious here, yeah? It is now an offence to mislead and obstruct an immigration officer, okay? So please think about that when you're answering my questions, right? Okay. Why have you come to the UK?
For the study.
Where?
School of Business Study.
School of Business Study?
Yeah.
Well, how come you give me letters for the School of Management and Science?
Yeah, School of Management, sorry.
No. Come on. Hey, stop wasting my time. Right, I'm going to ask you again, what are you doing in the UK? Because you're not studying, you can't even get the name of the college right.
My brother is very serious.
Yeah.
I came, stop this question, yeah. Simple as that. I am in a very bad situation.
Yeah, okay, simple right. So let's keep this simple. No. I tell you what, you listen to me, right? You calm down, right? And you answer my questions. Because the way you're going on, you've got something to hide, right? So don't start getting on your high horse, right? And start shouting at me, all right?
Did I shout on you?
You were.
I didn't.
Okay, right then.
So, I told you.
Right, listen. All you got to do is answer my questions, right? Simple as that. All right? Okay? Right.
Coming up, an enforcement team in London need to get their hands on a passport.
Oh, hold on. Got another photocopy of something here.
A student hopeful in India has forked out thousands on fees.
If you don't understand me, you have to tell me.
No.
Do you understand me?
And evidence that Officer Hassler's student can't be studying.
But can you clarify that the person works there then?
India's economy is booming. But a developing economy needs an educated workforce. And here in New Delhi, the demand for a British university degree is huge. Almost 35,000 people a year apply to study in Britain from India. It's down to entry clearance officers to choose the suitable candidates from those who don't make the grade. This man has travelled hundreds of miles to apply for his visa. He comes from a family of farmers, but he wants to study in the UK so he can go into business with his father-in-law.
You have to stare at that CCTV camera for 10 seconds.
Mr. Singh has a lot to lose, having already paid £4,500 for his first term alone.
It's my first time in UK for study. Firstly, my undergraduate Python program, and after I finish my bachelor degree in business administration.
Okay, so yeah. You're going to be a businessman?
Yeah.
And when you finish the degree, you're going to come back here?
Yeah.
And what are you going to do?
Yeah, and join my family business with my father-in-law and my father's.
His flight to the UK is only 4 days away from now.
My flight on 29th.
But there's no guarantee his application will be successful.
Thank you so much, sir. Have a good day.
Here at the application centre, Mr. Singh must submit evidence to prove that he's a genuine student and that his finances are in place.
Okay, this is your course for 3 years?
Yes, sir.
These are the savings?
Yeah.
It's a mountain of paperwork, but every detail is crucial.
We required the sponsor's document as well. Either the bank statement or the savings, the property papers, the valuation of the property, the affidavit, we required the whole thing actually.
He has everything he needs, but one part of his application is not up to scratch. His basic English score is below average. If the visa team don't think he'll be able to understand his course, they'll refuse him the visa. The money spent on fees could be lost. Students who are granted visas are only allowed to work part-time, up to 20 hours a week during term. At Terminal 3, Officer Hassler's passenger still insists he doesn't have a job at all, and that his studies are full-time.
When were you last at your college?
Sorry?
When were you last week?
First of May.
First of May?
What he doesn't know is that Officer Hassler has spoken to his cousin, who lets slip that he is working.
We'll be fortunate because I just asked the sponsor, his cousin who's meeting him, what work does he do? And he's just said, oh yeah, he's a taxi driver. But when I've started asking him anything more about it, he's got a bit hesitant, realising he's maybe said something he shouldn't have done. On that information, we'll be able to go now and, you know, go through the company. So it's been a good break for us.
Now, Officer Hassler needs to know whether it's full or part-time employment. And the pieces are coming together.
Taxi company's based in Luton. This is where this guy lives. Hi, is that the taxi company? Oh, hiya. I wonder if you can help me. This is the UK Border Agency at Heathrow. Just wonder if I could ask you a question about one of your drivers. Waleed Hussein? So, I mean, does he come on at a particular time or is it just any time? Is that full-time work? Yeah. Smashing. All right, thanks very much. Cheers, bye-bye now. Okay. Contact the company, and I've spoken to the controller there, and he's just confirmed that he does work there. He's been working there full time for 3 years. Right.
Officer Hassler still has no hard evidence. The cab company won't fax any information until they've spoken to the manager, who they can't get hold of. So he must use the information he has to get the full admission from the passenger.
Are you studying in the UK?
Yes.
Where?
I told you.
I'm asking you again, where?
School of Management Sciences.
All right, do you work in the UK?
No.
What did I say to you about lying to me, all right? Because you have lied to me. You have family in the UK?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So don't lie to me.
No, I am not lying.
So tell me again, where are you working?
I told you, in so many places I will...
No, no, where are you working now? Well, I know where you're working. You know where... I know where you're working. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm talking to you about it now, all right? So I want you to tell me.
Where are you working?
Yeah. Okay. Do you want me to tell you? So tell me about 49 Taxi Company, yeah? That you work there as a driver, yeah?
I did work
there. No, you do work there.
No, I'm not. No.
Yes, you are. Yeah, well, how come you suddenly mentioned that you've worked there and it wasn't mentioned before?
No,
Tell me.
So many places.
Okay. You tell me about 49 Taxi Company. You tell me about it, that you work as a taxi driver.
I did work,
okay, when did you start working there?
I did about 2-3 months ago.
So you still work there?
Yeah, I still work there. For 2 days.
I've got it from them that you work full time and you've worked there for at least 2 to 3 years. So you work there full time, yeah?
Part time.
Full time, yeah?
No, not full time.
Okay. So how come they're telling me you work full time and you've worked there for 3 years? And that probably tells me why you can't ever tell me about your college, because you're working full time.
I don't.
How much did you pay for those letters?
I didn't pay anything.
Well, you're not studying them.
No, I'm studying.
Okay, right, what's going to happen is we're going to put you into our holding room. You'll be remaining with us. We're going to get this in document. We're going to get this writing from this company, okay? Mm-hmm. We'll get all that relevant information, and then when we've got that, we're going to take this further, okay?
Yeah.
Officer Hassler didn't get a confession,
and
the evidence he needs won't be available until the morning. The passenger will have to stay in the holding room.
You're going to remain with us overnight?
No, I can't stay in this room. I can stay on this.
No, you will stay in this room, all right?
No, I can't, because I am asthmatic.
And if you've got asthma, where's your medication?
Do I get the medication with me?
Well, yeah, because...
No, I don't.
Well, come back. Where's your medication then?
No, I don't.
It's been a sort of frenetic few hours, but we've got the stage where we can't take this any further. We've got the passenger who's denying everything. However, we've got this verbal information that states that he is working full time. So clearly we have avenues that we need to go down, but we can't do that tonight. So I'll have to pass this on tomorrow morning to a day shift officer. And what they will do is contact the owner of the taxi company also the school as well, and just see if we can corroborate either his story or the information that we've been provided that he is actually working and not studying.
In Delhi, almost 200 student applications a week are vetted at the British High Commission. For Mr. Singh, who wants to study in England, this could be the most important interview of his life. His flight leaves in just 3 hours. Entry clearance officer Dan Brown will be taking his case.
Man Singh, please. Man Singh.
He's a 19-year-old student with no evidence that this guy speaks English. So we'll have a chat with him and see if his English is good enough to be able to follow the course. Morning, sir. How are you?
I'm fine, sir.
Okay, sir, but if you don't understand me, you have to tell me.
No.
Do you understand me?
Yeah.
So how long will you stay in the UK?
For my higher education, according to 3 years.
Where will you study?
Hertfordshire, sir.
Can you tell me about the structure of the course?
My father-in-law supporting me for fees and my residence and all costs.
But tell me about the structure of the course.
20,000 pounds, and in second and third year, four semester.
Okay, let me stop you there. I'll ask you the question in a different way. Can you tell me about the course that you will study in the UK?
Mainly reason of. I want to study in UK. And after study, I will join my family business and
Okay, sir, if you can please take a seat at the back, I'll consider your case and speak to you again shortly. Thank you. He's spending a lot of his father-in-law's money on going to the UK, and he couldn't tell me anything about what he was going to be studying. And I would expect that if he's spending so much money and he's really keen on studying, that he'd be able to tell me something about the course, and he could tell me absolutely nothing.
It's not looking good for Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh, I considered your application today, but I'm not satisfied that you meet the requirements of the rules this time, so I'm going to refuse your application. Do you understand?
Yes.
Mr. Singh won't be catching his flight today. Instead, he must explain the £4,500 down the drain to his father-in-law. The visa system acts as a filter, and strict border control stop many people getting into Britain illegally. But it's estimated there are up to 1 million illegal immigrants living and working in the country. It's the job of the enforcement teams to find those people and remove them from the UK.
First thing, we initially had 9 targets, however, that's been whittled down to 7. We've got intelligence received from the management of this company that they may be employing some persons who they believe may be illegal in this country. 5 minutes and we leave, yeah?
London and South East enforcement teams carry out over 100 raids a week. This morning, they've raided a cleaning company and arrested 2 workers they believe are in the country illegally. One is a Nigerian whose visa has expired. The other is from Ghana. There is no record of him entering the UK. Officer in charge, Sharon Kilbourne, decides to search the man's home.
We're establishing initially that he actually lives here and the keys fit into the lock. They do, so we're going to bring him up and conduct a house search in order to locate his passport and any other documentation.
Where's your bedroom? Where's your bedroom?
Upstairs.
Bedroom's upstairs. Just take him to your bedroom, yeah?
Last year, 25,000 illegal immigrants were removed from the country through enforcement. And the immigration teams are not allowed by law to remove someone without travel documents. They must have proof of the person's country of origin.
We've now verified that this is the person's room. If he gives us a passport, once we find that, we'll be out of here.
The team only have a photocopy supplied by the man's employer.
This gentleman has a
passport. The legal authority has certified it as being a true document. They took this to his employer. Of course, they're going to give him employment because it's been certified by a solicitor. These are the problems we have all the time.
Tell us if your passport is here. Saves us searching the whole room.
Right. To be, I said it first, to be honest with you.
Honesty is the best. We love honesty. Yeah. We love that.
To be honest with you.
Yeah.
When my brother was leaving,
yeah,
he told me everything in the lawyer's hand.
This gentleman here originally said that his passport was with the Home Office. Well, we've done checks. It's not with the Home Office, so we're going to check his details here. And now you're saying it's with the Home, your solicitor, yeah? It's with your solicitor?
No, I said I can give my solicitor number to you for you to ask.
All right.
Yeah, because
right, so where is it then?
I don't have any idea.
So you don't have any idea?
Yes.
Right, have you reported it to police?
No, to be honest.
Why not?
Has it been lost then? So if you don't know where it is...
Do you know what? If I had a pound for every time I heard someone lost their passport and never reported it to police, I'd be a rich woman.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Since my brother's, because everything was with my brother.
I just said to you, where's your passport? And you said, to be honest, I have no idea. But you just said now it's with a brother that's not really your brother.
My brother have that case, he have everything.
Sorry, you know what I mean?
Oh, hold on. Got another photocopy or something here.
I always keep everything.
It's a copy of his Ghanaian passport. Right, this was issued on the 1st of February, 2007.
Yeah, that's the point.
Right, where did you get this from? In Britain, this country or Ghana?
This one.
Yeah.
In this country.
From this country.
Yeah, when my brother was just sending everything.
So you wasn't here when you got this passport issued to you from...
Yeah,
from,
I was here.
You was here
to be
in
honest.
2007?
Yes, I was.
To be honest, yeah?
To be honest.
Yeah.
The moment it looks like the passport may not be here.
I think...
So, this gentleman will probably be asked to report on immigration bail. That'll be decided by the arresting officers.
The team know that without the travel document, they cannot remove the man from Britain. Their only option is to grant him temporary release.
But you have to report every week, you understand?
Right, temporary.
Otherwise you'll have problems if you get stopped again by the police or immigration.
Right.
Okay?
All right.
He'll be reporting to us until we can get a document and a removal date for him, and then he'll be removed back to his country of origin. So for him, if he's ever apprehended again, there won't be no release for him. He'll be detained until he's removed.
Coming up, officers in Calais check trucks bound for Britain.
Five adult males, it all claim to be from Palestine.
The taxi driver, who says he's a student, appeals to the chief.
I think if I gave you temporary admission, you probably wouldn't come back.
I will give you...
Well, but you don't appear to have followed our rules up to now, do you?
And it doesn't get any easier for the enforcement team.
Tell her, if she doesn't open the door, we'll smash the door in.
Nearly a million trucks a year come through the port of Calais carrying goods into Britain. Over 400 British immigration officers work here at the French border, checking that freight is all the trucks are carrying. In 2007, officers at Calais alone stopped nearly 12,000 people trying to cross the Channel illegally. Officer Gary Caldwell has been working the Calais beat for 3 years. It's his job to find and stop the illegal entrants, known here as clandestines, before they cross the French border.
We've just received a call from Amos Cork Security, which is a French firm that conduct searches down at the berths here. They've searched the lorry that they think they found five clandestines in. So we're going to make our way down now, have a look at it. The clandestines may have breached the port fence and got into the lorry whilst it's been parked down here.
First, Officer Caldwell must make sure that the clandestines aren't carrying any weapons.
No sharps? No?
No, no.
Yeah?
No, no.
No? Okay. Yeah, what we've got is it's a level load of white goods, as you can see. And in a space maybe this high, across the top, there are five adult males that all claim to be from Palestine. We're going to move them down one at a time. We'll refer the circumstances to our CIO. And then they'll make a decision on whether or not we're going to serve illegal entry papers on these people. You're first. He just said to me, everybody likes England, which is why they're They're trying to make their way across there right now. Come on, don't worry too much about that, Wayne. It's only spitting.
Please follow the signs for correct immigration
zones. 10 a.m. Terminal 3.
Mr. Rogers, you're saying?
It's been a bad night for the passenger who says he's a student and claims he doesn't work. He's been detained in the holding room for 13 hours. And now officers have written confirmation from the taxi company that he's been working full time. He's refused entry and told to be put on a plane in 2 hours. But he has a wife and 2 children living in Luton. He asked to see the chief immigration officer, Matt Dyson.
Sometimes I think they believe that if they talk to the senior officer, he's going to turn around and be more sympathetic. But to be honest, you know, this decision's been through 2 CIOs now, so it's not a decision I'm looking to overturn at all. So, but we can all see what he's got to say. Do you want to come and have a quick chat? I'm the chief, yeah? We'll just nip outside. What's up?
I just want to make a request.
Mm-hmm.
That I got my wife and my daughters, 2 daughters in Luton, yeah? And I just want to request you personally for the bail. I'm not saying your decision.
No, as it stands, I'm not willing to entertain any releasing you at the moment, okay?
You can do that.
If you wish to appeal. No, I'm not granting you temporary admission. I think that's what you're asking for, isn't it? Temporary admission. No, because I think if I gave you temporary admission, you probably wouldn't come back.
I will give you
Well, but you don't appear to have followed our rules up to now, do you? No, I've read this. The case against you is pretty strong, okay? I don't think you're studying. You don't know anything about your course.
If any guarantee you want, I can bring them
to 3 people. I can't really do that. I mean, I can understand why you're concerned about your wife and daughters. Well, no, I mean, you're concerned about your wife and daughter, but obviously, you know, I have to balance that concern with the fact that, you know, you fall well short of re-entering as a student. And also, you didn't seem to think it was a problem going on holiday and leaving your wife and daughters here, did you?
No.
So it's not as if, you know, I think that they're in any danger.
My brother is dying with the cancer, leukemia. He's fighting for his life in hospital. That was the reason I went to leave my wife and my kids.
Right, as whilst I can understand you want to see your wife and children, I'm not going to be letting you in, I'm afraid. If you want to pursue the appeal, that's up to you. You can never divorce yourself entirely from the decisions you make. But in the end, you have to look to your job, and you have to look what is the right thing to do according to your job. Now, you should never, ever divorce yourself from being sympathetic towards people. And just because somebody falls short of the immigration rules doesn't automatically make them a bad person. Now, as far as we can gather, this guy is working too much and he's not studying as he claims. Okay. And his whole basis of being here and also of having a family here whom he supports is as a student. And the bottom line is if he's not doing it, then he shouldn't be here. And, you know, that's the law, and that's a policy made by government, not by me. My job is to apply it correctly.
The passenger did lodge an appeal before Chief Officer Dyson's team could put him on a plane. After a week in a detention centre, he was granted temporary release. He's still in the UK waiting for a removal date. Back at Calais, an officer Caldwell is on a roll. There's another report of a lorry with clandestines on board.
We've got 3 clandestines in the vehicle in front, believe it or not. It's gone mad. No. Yes. I need your photograph. I can come up and get it if you like. Okay? And him. Come on, fella. Nationality? Iraq? Iran?
Two Iraq, 1 Iran.
Okay. Nationality? Iranian.
Iraq.
Passport?
Passport? No.
No papers. Papers?
Papers.
Let me see. Yeah. Okay, from the French police. Ali Kalen?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
But what we look at is how secure the vehicle was, what measures that the drivers and indeed their companies take to prevent clandestines breaching them. So we'll speak with the drivers to establish what if anything they've done to protect their lorries, and then we'll consider setting penalties if we think it's appropriate after that. Clandestines now, that we'll take their photographs and fingerprint them. We'll consider or not whether they've committed an offence. We'll serve them paperwork confirming that. And once that's done, we'll hand them to the French police, who will remove them from the area.
The enforcement team in London need to search the home of a cleaner they've arrested on suspicion of being in the country illegally.
Come on, mate. Watch your head, yeah?
Kind of. Stand here for me, mate.
The man gave a false name, but officers found an ID card, and checks against this name confirmed he is from Nigeria and here on a tourist visa that expired 2 years ago.
The gentleman says it's his sister's address and she lives on the fifth floor. We've got officers providing rear cover just in case someone throws documents out of windows.
The team must find his passport. Without it, they can't send him back home.
No, hold him, he can go. Because his sister's a bit nervous of the law and police, and especially immigration, he's asked us to stand away from the people, or she won't answer the door, basically. If she sees his face, she'll answer it. If she sees us, she won't. So we're just waiting for her to answer the door.
Hello, I'm Hello,
Don't open the door, immigration going to arrest you.
Yeah,
that's what he's saying.
Can you let me use your phone? I'll call him. I'll call her. I will explain what is happening. Excuse me. I will explain what is happening to her. She will open the door. Let me just... She's just only afraid.
Tell her if she doesn't open the door, we'll smash the door in.
Let me use the phone.
You got to do it in English?
Yeah, I'll tell her what is happening.
If there's no one in there.
Because she might not be there, innit? Hello, Lucy! It's the Home Office. Open the door! We're not going to go away, so you need to open the door now!
We don't want a false entry, unless we're sure it's his address. Because we don't, obviously, we've only got the power to false entry into his address, and we're not 100% sure. So we're not too keen on kicking the door in.
Is your passport in there, or is it in a different address?
Is there a passport in this address? Your passport in there?
You remember? No, my passport. My passport is not here.
Where is your passport?
My passport is for a long time. It is has been returned to Nigeria from
right.
those
well,
who have taken
it. That's what you said earlier, is it? Sunny, I don't believe you.
You can check it. You know how to check it from your computer. Check it by yourself. You will see everything there.
You're saying you've applied for another visa?
You mean my visa?
Why have you returned your passport back to Nigeria?
It is because, you know, so,
just a short story, please. Why have you returned it back to Nigeria? Why?
It's someone that has helped me that take it back to Nigeria.
You come here, you get a visa, you send it home, get a new visa, pretend you've gone back to Nigeria, put a fake landing state from someone in Nigeria, get a new visa, yeah? We know how it works. This is not a new story to us. We hear this every day. Now, where's your passport?
You know, what I'm saying now, I'm very, very sure of what I'm saying. Forget about what happened in where you come and listen. It's just a panic.
But
now, I'm ready to tell you the root part of the matter.
Okay. Where's your passport?
My passport is not here. It's not been in this England. And I have to tell you the truth. I swear to Almighty God.
The team can't get in. They've already spent 8 hours on this operation. And at the end of it, two people they believe are illegal immigrants will be released.
It's just frustrating because you've been out all day. It's a long, hard graft. And at the end of it, you're just going to let go.
Because of limited space, the Immigration Service only detains someone if they believe he poses a risk to the public or is likely to abscond. All they can do with the Nigerian is take him back to base to record his details.
All right, we'll start off with your right hand, so come around here.
So
Excuse me, sir. Can I ask you a question, please?
Yes.
Never commit any crime in this country.
What? Okay, listen, mate. We're going to give you. I'll tell you why we're taking your fingerprints.
Very straightforward.
Okay, now listen. Let me explain to you. Mm-hmm. You're not legally here.
Yeah,
and we have the right to take your fingerprints. Okay.
Yeah.
If you don't allow to take them, we can take them by force. Okay. It's a lot easier for you to just let us take them. Mm-hmm. Don't go to the police. These go onto an immigration database, but they go on an immigration database all around Europe. So you go to any other country within Europe, claim to be somebody else, they can test you and you'll come up on your fingerprints. Okay?
It's not that you know me, I've committed a crime.
It's not because you've done a criminal offence, no. Just do what go with me, yeah?
I'm going to give you this form. It's a notification of temporary release, okay? Basically means that we're releasing you. You need to report to this office. You need to bring this paper with you, right? And then you come back every Wednesday, okay? You're not allowed to work, mate, yeah? So the best bet for you now is probably to go to the Nigerian High Commission and get hold of a passport or a travel document and go back to Nigeria, okay?
If I've been deported to Nigeria, they will kill me. If I prefer to kill me here and there to die in Nigeria, before they kill me, they to go to Nigeria and just waste my life.
The man fears for his life if he goes home to Nigeria because of a feud over property with members of his family. It started after the death of his parents, when he sold some property to fund his trip to Britain.
I mean, we spoke about the possibility of you wanting to claim asylum, but you're not sure yet, are you? So what you need to do is go home, have a think about it, and whatever you think's best, when you decide, when you come in tomorrow, you'll come into our office and have a word with someone about claiming asylum, if that is what you want to do, okay?
Asylum is protection for people fleeing persecution in their own country. A claim because of a family dispute, however serious, is unlikely to be successful.
Well, now he's been released, he's probably going to go home, speak to his mates. They're going to tell him, oh no, stay away, whatnot. And lost in the system again.
The man did report as instructed the following day, but he did not seek asylum and has not been seen or heard of since. The Ghanaian cleaner also reported only once before disappearing. Both men have been circulated as absconders on the police national computer. Coming up, that's boiling point for the Aussie chef.
Look, you've read my diary, you've been through everything. I'm not here to work.
At Heathrow, a 41-year-old Australian claiming to be a tourist has been stopped at passport control. Officer Devinder Tung is suspicious because the woman has limited funds and can't tell him what she wants to do while on holiday. The passenger is a chef, and Officer Tung believes she may intend to work in Britain. What she's carrying in her luggage raises suspicions further.
She's just informed me that she's got some special luggage that she's checked in, which she said were her chef knives. Now, when asked why she needed them, she said she was going to do some cooking for her uncle. Is that all the baggage that you have at the moment?
Yeah, except my knives are in the fridge.
Your knives are in the fridge. Okay, we'll go and grab your knives. Okay, I'm just going to have to take this away from you as well, just whilst we're conducting our inquiries, okay? I can't let you have this, and then I'll return it back to you afterwards, okay?
Officer Tung must search all the woman's bags to find out if she is a genuine tourist. In with her laptop, he discovers several copies of the woman's CV.
We also have copies of her educational certificates with her. She's got copies of them. I mean, it's strange, you know, someone bringing educational certificate CVs coming for a holiday. At her age, 41, she's too old to get a working holiday maker visa to come here through that channel. I haven't looked at her qualifications exactly, but you know, we've got the new points-based system, so maybe she doesn't qualify for the points to get the right work permits to come over. So, you know, they're left with no other option but to come and seek entry as a visitor and then work illegally. And can I ask you what this is? What's this?
It's a CV.
that I use, how I get work in, this is what I, how I send to my employers. This goes electronically.
Whose CV is it?
Mine, Robin Cameron's.
Why are you bringing them with you?
They're always in my, back, in my laptop. They're always there.
They're always there?
They're always in my bag, yeah.
So many copies? You've got about 25 copies of your covering letter.
Yeah.
And there must be maybe the same amount of CVs. Yeah.
When I'm looking for work, that's what I send them. Always looking for work, but you always get bits and pieces.
You're always looking for work?
Yeah.
Why are you carrying your chef knives with you?
Because I'm going to cook some food for my friends while I'm here. I take them everywhere I go.
Can you not use their knives to cook food?
No, because they're blunt. You always cut, no.
Why not?
No, because people, I can't.
Because you're only going to cook for friends. How many friends do you have here? You have...
Yeah, but even when I'm at home in Sydney, you have an uncle. To people's house.
Yeah, you have an uncle to cook for.
Yeah.
And you have Julie to cook for, and another... Yeah. So there's three people.
I don't like using anyone else's knives. It's, just, it's a personal thing that I've had my own knives. People's knives are normally blunt.
Okay. I mean, looking at what we've done, what we've looked at so far, everything suggests to me that you're coming to the United Kingdom to seek and take employment here.
But I can't get a working visa here.
Yeah.
No, I can't work here.
But no, everything suggests to me that you are, because, I mean, why else would somebody carry a CV with them? You have three friends here.
Yeah.
And you've bought your chef knives to cook for them.
But if you could understand what
it's... I do understand, but...
The chefs are like...
You're not cooking... Unless you plan to cook in a professional kitchen, you don't need to bring your knives with you.
If I go to my dad's house, I take my knives. If I go to anyone's house to cook for them, I take my knives.
So do you have any intention of working here?
No, I don't.
Okay.
What did she say about the knives and the certificates?
Well, she always carries them around with her wherever she goes. She's always looking for work. I said, you're always looking for work. You're planning to work here? No, I'm not planning to work here.
I don't buy this thing about taking your chef's knives everywhere you go. And you don't take your certificate.
No, you
don't.
When
did you last take yours on holiday?
No, and it's not just one. There's a few copies of each. It's not just like, you know, she's got different coloured one. Here we go. This is her CV.
Is that her?
That's her, yeah.
No, she's looking for work, isn't
she? Oh, she's definitely looking for work, yeah.
Nope. Sorry.
I've checked RDs. There's a flight out tonight at 2100 or something.
She's fitting well?
Yeah, she's fitting well. This is for you. Your reasons for refusal. This also gives you your flight that you're going back on. So you're going on the EY to Abu Dhabi, connecting on all the way to Sydney tonight.
Okay.
Okay? Your passport and stuff will be held with us. When you board the flight, my colleagues who will escort you to your flight will then hand the passport on to the cabin crew, who will then give it to you when you land.
There's nothing I can do.
Unfortunately not, no.
This is so wrong. I've worked my ass off to get here. I'm a chef. I make $25 an hour in Sydney. I've worked that hard. Look, you've read my diary. You've been through everything. I'm not here to work.
Okay. Well, everything that you've brought with you suggests that you are here and your intentions are to seek employment here in the United Kingdom.
You can keep all that.
No, that's not going to stop.
I know. I just grabbed my laptop. My laptop had recipes in it.
She didn't take it too well. She'd spent a lot of money. I mean, it didn't seem as if she had limited funds to her anyway. Now, you know, someone wouldn't spend all that money to come here just for a trip if they didn't have it. I mean, there must have been more intentions to her coming here, like to work so she could earn some more money. So I think that was the right decision.
I've worked my ass off for the last 6 months to come to this country to have a holiday. I brought my knives, I'm a chef, I'm going to cook for my friends, and they've refused me entry into this country. It's just so wrong. You know, he wants me to bring my family. My family just had the biggest party for me to leave yesterday, and now I'm going to bring him with children and come home. I'm embarrassed and I'm upset and I've done nothing wrong. I've done nothing wrong except for trying to come to this country.